Hi everybody, welcome back to Multirate Signal Processing, this time about the discrete cosine transform and polyphase representation. So first to the notation. Last time we saw the equivalent impulse responses for analysis and synthesis for the DFT. Observe that our convention is to multiply the signal vector or row vector from the left hand side onto the transform matrix. In the literature, also the other way around is used, with the signal vector being a column vector multiplied from the right-hand side onto the transform matrix. The transform matrix is then also the transposed version, right? So remember last time for the analysis filter bank, we had the transform matrix containing the impulse responses in the columns, but flipped, right, from up, from bottom to up. But if we multiply the signal from the other side, from the right-hand side as a column vector, then the impulse response of the filters appears in the rows in the flipped version. Remember, I mentioned it briefly that there is this difference, and here we can now see it. So you need to be aware of this difference in notation. You can actually find both. So I tend to use the signal coming from the left-hand side because that usually matches block diagram description where you have the signal usually going from the left to right. So here you have x as a row vector times t, the transform matrix, is the resulting subbands, again as a row matrix. Yeah, so this has the advantage that it corresponds to a signal flow diagram from left to right. The following is the alternative notation, where you have x coming from the right-hand side, and this corresponds more to the mathematical notation of functions. And you have a function f of x, and then x usually appears in the argument of on the right-hand side. So this would be suitable for mathematicians for whom this function notation is more common. So here we have the signal coming from right-hand side and y being the result. Yeah, so you can find both, but you have to be aware of those differences. So next is the discrete cosine transform, the DCT. This is another widely used block transform, and the DCT of type 4 is defined in this equation here, which I also defined in lecture 2. So here you can see the resulting subband sample of block number M, subband index K is obtained by the sum. So again, like with the DFT and with the transform matrix notation, you get the sum. For the analysis, the sum goes over the time index lowercase n from 0 to the end of a block capital N minus 1. And you can see x, m again is the block index, m times capital N plus n the in-block index. Here we have the transform kernel cosine of pi over n times n plus 0.5 times k plus 0.5. And this addition of 0.5 is typical for the type 4, right? The type 4 has this plus 0.5 in both n and k. And this makes the transform matrix then symmetric because there's no difference in shape between n and k. Yeah, so this is for the analysis. And as I mentioned, characteristic here is the shift of 0.5 in the subband index k and the time index n. As comparison, this is the DCT type 2 analysis transform, which is defined in this equation. And here you can see the 0.5 appears only together with the time index lowercase n, but not with the subband index k. Right, so that's the type 2. And for the type 2, we also need to have this constant ck which makes the resulting transform matrix orthonormal. So remember here in the previous case, we simply had this constant square root of 2 over capital N. So this is a constant which makes the resulting transform matrix orthonormal, which means the inverse will be simply the transpose. And here we need to have this additional factor of CK, and CK is 1 for all the subbands K except for the first one, where it is 0.5. And that comes actually because for K equals 0, the cosine terms become 1, and then we simply have a sum over the x, and we need to have this square root of 0.5 to make it orthonormal. Yeah, so observe that the only difference is that the DCT4 also has a shift of 0.5 for the frequency index k. So the DCT2 is mostly used for images and video coding, whereas the DCT type 4 is mostly used for audio signals. Yeah, and it turns out that the DCT2 is more suitable for images because they are all the higher subbands for k equals 1 and higher have in the frequency response a 0 at frequency DC. And since images and video have most energy around frequency 0, which is DC, this gives a good separation and compression performance. But audio doesn't have this property. Audio has most energy not at zero, but somewhat above zero at low frequencies. And there, the property of the DCT4 that you have those evenly spaced frequency bands, which you obtain with this plus 0.5, is more important. Yeah, otherwise you would have a more narrow band for k equals 0. Yeah, so using the definition of the DCT4, we can now construct the transform matrix and extract the equivalent impulse responses, as we saw last time. The analysis transform matrix becomes this. We simply take this transform kernel here, and we can see element n and k has this form. So the impulse response of the equivalent analysis filter are then the time reversed columns of this. So for each k, we just flip n, right? And this is what we get here. So hk of n is simply this equation and the n flipped. So we have n minus 1 minus lowercase n. And in this way, we get capital N impulse responses. For the inverse DCT4 transform, we obtain the synthesis filters. Observe that the DCT4 is orthogonal or even orthonormal, meaning that the inverse of T is T transpose. And the DCT4 is also symmetric, meaning T transpose is identical to T. And this came because of the same shape for n and k. So it doesn't really matter here in this formula if we have n or k switched. That's why we have t transpose equals t. And that's why we get t inverse is t, right? So we don't need to do anything to obtain the inverse. The inverse matrix is simply inverse to it's simply the matrix itself. So the synthesis impulse responses are simply the rows of this transform matrix, which in this case is identical to the columns. Right, and now we don't need to flip it. We just take this equation here, gk of n is this transform kernel here. So we see that they are simply the time-reversed analysis filter, since here we don't need the time reversal. Right, so that's very convenient. Here we have perfect reconstruction filter banks with critical sampling, both desirable properties for coding. But our equivalent filters are restricted to a length of capital N. Right? This was the problem with block transforms. They can only be as long as one block. This leads to filters which do not really have good frequency responses we get wide transition bands for our bandpass filters relative to the width of the passband, and not enough stop and attenuation. So that's not so good. So we have perfect reconstruction, critical sampling, but now our filters are not so good. So here's a Python example for the DCT4. So again, we are using IPython minus PyLab. So I can do it here again in my little terminal. So again, starting IPython minus PyLab. So here we get this colorful prompt. And we can start entering the code. N equals 4. Then T, we start with initializing it with 4 times 4 zeros. So we have a 2x2 array of 4x4 zeros, two-dimensional array. And now we have those two for loops, which assigns the transform kernel to this matrix, right? So we just take this cosine expression here. Here is the constant, square root of 2 over n. Here our cosine pi divided by 4 times n plus 0.5 times k plus 0.5. And remember, 4 was our capital N, right? So now we can paste it here. So now we have our T. And you can see here, we have now our values for our transform matrix T for capital N equals 4. Right, so you can see here it's identical. So this is now our transform matrix for capital N equals 4 for the DCT4. So now we can plot the frequency response of the analysis filter, for instance, for subband k equals 0. So the first subband, which will be our low-pass filter. So again, we have to use SciPy signal because that contains our function fregz. Then after computing fregz on this flipped first column of our transform matrix, we compute the magnitude and the dB values of it. Horizontally, we plot the frequency, sampling points, give the axis labels and the entire thing a title. And then we can compute it. Oh, that was wrong. I need to copy it. Copy. Yes. So here you can now see the result. And you can see it behaves like a low pass. So here it's pass band. Then you have the transition band here. And here you get the stop band. But when you look at the attenuation compared to the pass band, so here you maybe have 5 dB. Here you have around minus 8. So that gives us maybe 13 dB attenuation compared to the passband, which usually is not enough. And it's also in our application of audio coding, not really enough. Or application of sampling rate conversion is also not enough. So we have less than about 20 dB here in our resulting frequency response. So that's not really good. A solution is to allow filters with longer impulse response. So here we can see a solution to obtain more stop band attenuation is to allow filters with longer impulse responses. Longer than the block size capital N. This would lead to non-square transform matrices, but non-square matrices are not invertible in general. We can only obtain a pseudo-inverse, hence we would lose perfect reconstruction, which is a problem because we want to keep it. Alternatively, we could have overlapping blocks, which could provide perfect reconstruction, but then we would lose critical sampling. Again, a problem for coding applications, right? So our goal is to obtain longer filters, have the same block length for critical sampling and perfect reconstruction. So how do we do that? How do we get longer filters and still keeping critical sampling and perfect reconstruction? So that's the problem that we will solve using the polyface representation, which I will introduce now. So this means the transform matrix approach or view comes to its limit. We need new tools, and this leads us to the polyface representation, which can be seen as an extension of the transform matrix approach or as a mixture between the transform view and the filter bank view. So let's start with a polyface representation. First, the analysis filter bank. We start with writing our analysis filters or analysis filtering with FIR filters of length capital L and downsampling operation in terms of our block index lowercase m and an in-block or phase index lowercase n, where n is between 0 and capital N minus 1, because it's in block. The original formulation for our subband signals for the convolution and downsampling with phase n naught was this, right? So here we have our convolution equation, including downsampling here, and we can see here again block index. Here we have our time index, which is in this case not limited to the block, and here's our filter. So in general, we assume that the filter length capital L is an integer multiple of capital N. We can always zero pad it if necessary. We can now split the sum into an in-block processing with a phase index n that runs just from 0 to capital N minus 1, and an out-of-block processing with a block index lowercase m prime, which runs from 0 to the end of the filter by using an index substitution. So now we want to turn this lowercase n into an in-block index together with a block index m prime. In this way, the index m prime corresponds to our downsampled index. To obtain the same ordering for the signal x as we used for our block transform approach, with its index lowercase n going up, we substitute in this way. So lowercase n is substituted by our block index m prime times block size capital N, plus now the reversed in-block index here, n minus 1 minus n. Right, in this way we get the same ordering as in the transform approach. And we choose the downsampling phase as n naught equals n minus 1. And this gives us this equation here. So again, at first glance it looks more complicated because we have now two summations here, two sums. One goes over the block index m prime, and one goes over the in-block index lowercase n. And here we have our x, again block indices m and m prime. And here's now our filter impulse response, and you can see here instead of lowercase n we have this substitution going on here now. And we can compare it here. Here this n naught was n minus 1, and that cancelled the n minus 1 here from the substitution. So this doesn't look so complicated. Yeah, so this is this in-between result. Observe that this is still our filter bank formulation, but the interesting part here is that the inner sum again looks like our block transform formulation, right? With blocks or vectors of size capital N and an impulse response along the column vector of length capital N. So here, this inner part here now looks like our transform equation, because the sum only goes from 0 to capital N minus 1, even though the filter is longer. Right? That's the major difference now. We still have this limited length because we do the in-block processing and we account for the longer filter length by using this outer sum here going over the blocks of the impulse response HK. So this is now an important trick which we will continue. So we already obtained something similar to our previous known approach and can use it now. Yeah. So we can reformulate or simplify the inner sum now as a vector multiplication when we rewrite the impulse response h of n as a vector which contains a sequence of blocks as before. Right now we have hk of m, m is the block index again, and that contains the blocks of our impulse response. First block contains the first n samples, next block contains the next n samples, and so on. Same for our signal. So here we have the signal, which contains the blocks of the signal. Yeah, and also observe that the ordering here for the in-block samples is reversed for our HK, right? Here we start with a higher index, go down to the lower index. And for the signal, we start at the lower index and go up to the higher index. So this is again because in our transform notation, we needed to flip the impulse responses, right? So the transform matrix contained the flipped impulse response in its columns. And that's why this vector here now appears flipped. Right. So taking those two vectors, sequences of blocks, we can simply rewrite this inner sum here. So this is our inner sum of equation 8. So look at this again here. Here it's simply factored out the n, capital N here. We have capital N times m minus m prime in this case. And that leads us to this expression here, m minus m prime times capital N plus n, and this is unchanged. And when we now replace these signals by those two vectors, we get to this simple expression. So here we have x of m minus m prime times h transpose of k of m prime. So you can see here when we look at this expression, it is indeed identical. So this vector multiplication is then identical to this sum here. So that already looks a lot simpler, right? So instead of having this inner sum, we simply have this vector notation. And this is already looking like our transform notation. Remember in the transform notation, we also had a signal block times the transform matrix, and this is sort of that like one of the columns of the transform matrix. This is the kth column of the transform matrix. So we managed to write it like a transform matrix multiplication. Yeah, so this inner part is pretty much like the transform now. But remember, we also had an outer sum. So hence, using these two vectors, we can replace the inner sum by this vector multiplication and rewrite or simplify equation 8 into this. So now we have this inner sum here, but we still have this outer sum going over the block index m prime, the block index for our impulse response. Yeah, so the inner part of the sum now looks like our block transform if we view our impulse response HK as one reverse column of a transform matrix. So again, this is the transform view inside the filter bank view with longer filters, which is why we also have the outer sum, the out of block processing, a convolution. Right? So if you look at this expression here, the sum here looks exactly like a convolution. But now this is a convolution over blocks instead of over samples. So each x of m minus m prime is a block. Same here. So here this convolution sum, which we can see here, this m prime is going down, here this m prime is going up. So this is typical for a convolution. But now we have a convolution over a sequence of blocks instead of a sequence of samples. So we kind of generalized now the convolution. Yeah, so the remaining outer sum now looks like a convolution again, but now with a sequence of blocks instead of samples, we have a vector convolution, right? So here the output of our filter bank is a convolution of the sequence of blocks of our signal, the audio signal for instance, with the sequence of our impulse response blocks. Yeah, so that now makes it a lot simpler and allows us to also use our transform notation. Observe that our downsampling factor is now embedded in our block size, right? So the downsampling factor determines the block size. This has the advantage that we can now apply the Z-transform to this equation to turn the convolution into a multiplication. Right? Here we have a convolution, and we know that a convolution is turned into a multiplication using the Z-transform. So we just need to apply the Z-transform to the sequence of blocks in X and in H. Right. So first we need to z-transform our vectors, starting with the signal vector x of m in the time domain. So here, this is our x of m. So the question is, how do we z-transform a sequence of vectors? When you look at it, it's quite simple because you can view the sequence of vectors as a vector of downsampled sequences. Right. So again, first entry is the downsampled x starting at phase number 0. The next entry is the downsampled x starting with the first entry, phase number 1, until we get to the last phase index n minus 1. So in the sequence, when you look down along the columns of this sequence, you get downsampled versions of x with different phase indices n naught. So here we have n naught equals 0, here we have n naught equals n minus 1. And for each of those, you can apply the z-transform, right? So then we get this xn of z, which is the z-transform of each of those entries. So here we take the first downsampled sequence, apply the z-transform to it, and we get x0 of z. And the last one, we get xn minus 1. So this is what we can see here. And this then becomes a polyphase vector. So we have the z-transformed sequence of blocks x in the z-domain becomes capital boldface x of z. And that consists of the z-transforms of each of those downsampled sequences at different phase entries n naught. Right, so this is the result. Or you could also write it as x, capital X of z is simply the sum of x of m times z to the minus m, where x of m again is those blocks. So for each m we get a block, and we multiply each block with z to the minus m by multiplying each element of the block with z to the minus m, and that we get the same result, right? Again, it's simply a different viewpoint. If you view it horizontally along the samples, then we have the blocks. If you view it vertically along the phases, we get the downsampled signals with different phases. The result is the same. It's just different viewpoints. Yeah, so now we have n phases, and because of that we call this polyphase, right? Because each of those phases here is a different phase, a collection of phases. So we have several phases, many phases, hence polyphase. Yeah, and we use the same method for the vector of impulse responses. So we call this H, capital H K of Z, and we get a vector of Z transformed downsampled sequences of our impulse response at different phases again, but here with flipped phases again, because in the transform matrix view we had the flipped columns as impulse responses. Yeah, so here same definition for the polyphase elements. For the Z transforms we take the downsampled sequences of our impulse response at different phases n, and you obtain the polyphase Z transform. Yeah, so the output of our kth filter is still just a polynomial, not a vector of matrix. So here the output of our kth filter yk is simply yk, the downsampled y transformed, right? So we have the downsampled output of each of those subband filters. And remember, we chose phase number n minus 1 so that it fits our derivation. We have subband number k. This is the downsampling which was going on, and this is the resulting output. And from our equations, we can see that this output resulted from yk equals x times h. Because it was a convolution in the time domain, it is now a multiplication in the z domain. Right? And since x and h are vectors, we have this row vector in the z domain, we have this column vector in the z domain, just like in our transform notation, and that gives us the value of the kth subband. So here this is just one value or one polynomial, that's why it's not boldface. Here we have a row vector, here we have a column vector. Yeah, so here we rewrote the analysis filter and subsequent downsampling by this multiplication of vectors in the Z domain. Right? So here it simply became a multiplication. So that's good, because it's simpler and lends itself to invertibility. Yeah, for an implementation, we can convert this equation back into the time domain, starting with rewriting the vector multiplication as a sum over the phase index n. Right, so here we now go back, so we have this multiplication in the Z domain, and here you can see how we do the multiplication of the row times the column, right? So we can see here basically our matrix multiplication, and the multiplications in the Z domain become a sum with simple convolutions in the time domain. So here now we have two simple Z transforms, and when we go back to time, then they turn into convolutions. Right, you can see it. So here we have the polyphase entries, and we convolve each of those polyphase entry pairs with each other. And this is something that is, for instance, easily implementable when you have a time domain signal. So this is the sum over the phases of the convolution of the blocks. Right, so here you can see n, lowercase n, here's the phase, and here's the corresponding phase for the impulse responses, the downsampled impulse responses. So with this equation, we can now implement the polyphase structure in the time domain, if we wish. So here's a visualization of the polyphase elements and the blocks. Given a signal x of n and a downsampling rate of capital N equals 2, we get the following blocks and polyphase elements. So again here, first block x0, x1, next block x2, x3, and if you look horizontally, we get the different blocks. If we view it vertically, we get the different phases. First column is phase 0, next column is phase 1. Right, so that's why here in the first column we get x downsampled at phase n not equals 0, and the next column is x downsampled by 2 at phase number 1, n not equals 1. Yeah, here is a simple Python polyphase example. Assume we have a signal x equals 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, right, simple enough. And we downsample by a factor of n equals 3. And then we get the signal blocks x of m with m in a range as we need to fit the signal as x0, 5, 6, 7, so that's the first block. And x1 would be 8, 9, 10, right, so we just need two blocks. We can use Python SymPy to use three-dimensional arrays or tensor to represent the coefficients of the different exponents of z in the third dimension. Right, so I'm now taking advantage of Python SymPy to represent z as a symbol. Right, so this gives us a more easily readable code because we keep the symbol here. And Python has this advantage that it has symbolic calculations capabilities in its library SymPy. So that's very practical. So again, let's go back to my IPython terminal shell. So here I import SymPy, copy and define the symbol, paste. Oh, no module SymPy. Yeah, so this is actually something you have to install if you don't have it already installed. And you do that, for instance, with sudo pip install SymPy. Let's see if that works. Yeah, it found SymPy and now it's installing. So this is one of the big advantages of using Linux. In Linux, it's really easy to install libraries in this way. So going back to IPython minus minus pylab. So now paste. Yes. So now it has SymPy and we have z. Right, z is a symbol. You can see here when I type z, it doesn't tell us any content because it's a symbol, it stays z. So now we can assign the blocks. Here I have this three-dimensional matrix, or three-dimensional array rather, because matrices are always two-dimensional. So I initialize it and then I assign the two blocks. So paste. So now you can see XP. So here we have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And now we compute XZ as a sequence of blocks Z transformed. So you can see here's the first block. So you can see here the middle index contains our block. So here the first index is not really used. The second index contains our indices, our samples, and the last index corresponds to the block index. So here we have block index 0, here we have block index 1. So we can also see it here in the terminal shell. If I say xp of 0, 0, 0, this is the block and this is the block index. So here block index 0, 5, 6, 7, and here block index 1, we have 8, 9, 10. So these are now our two blocks. And we can simply turn them into a Z transform by multiplying the second block with Z to the minus 1. Right, so I will do that. Apply my Z transform to it. And this also shows you how you can Z transform sequences of blocks. Right, simply you treat each block like you would treat a sample in the Z transform. So here you can see the result, right? So you can see here we have in 5, 6, 7. So this is the first block with z to the power of 0. And then the second block with a factor of z to the minus 1. So 8, 9, 10, right? So in this way, we obtain the z transform of a sequence of blocks. And as a result, we get a block containing polynomials, right? Here we have a block of the same size, three entries, but each entry is now a polynomial, right? And the polynomial now contains the downsampled sequence at the corresponding phase and Z-transformed. Yeah, so this is what we got. This is the Z-transform of a sequence of blocks. And yeah, here we can see our polyphase elements, 5 plus 8 times z to the minus 1 as the first entry here, then 6 plus 9 z to the minus 1 as the next entry, and the last one is 7 plus 10 times z to the minus 1. You can see down here. So this is then our polyphase vector, right? It contains those three polynomials. So in this way, we can have basically arbitrary length signals. So even if you have a signal which contains, I don't know, 1,000 blocks, then you would simply have polynomials of order 1,000 in here, right? But still just three polynomials. Yeah, so we see that it corresponds to our Python output. Assume we have the first analysis impulse response of H0 equals 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 for capital N equals 3. Then we also get a corresponding polyphase vector just with the flipped phases here, starting with the highest phase and going down to the lowest phase. And using this example, we would get this polyphase representation in the Z domain. Right here, you have the first block, 3, 4, 5. So remember, it's flipped. And then 6, 7, 8 for the next block. So here in Python, we get this representation. So here we have the two flipped blocks. So going to my terminal, paste. So now HP contains our two blocks in the flipped ordering. And now we compute the Z transform of it and print it. Pretty print it. Oops, it's not defined. So here we have HZ. This is our output. So this is basically what we expected. So now we can do the filtering with downsampling as a multiplication of the polyphase matrices XZ and HZ. So here we just need to multiply our two just obtained polyphase vectors. here the row vector in the z-domain times the column vector of the impulse response. And we do that using the function dot. Right? So remember, dot was a matrix multiplication. And I already constructed HP such that here the indices were in the first, samples are in the first index. So here we have basically already the transpose H. Right? Remember here for X, we had the second index. And for H, we have the first index. So this means H already appears transpose here. So here we have a column vector in HZ. So we can simply apply the dot function directly to XZ and HZ because HZ is already transposed. So I don't need to transpose it explicitly here. Yeah, so let's try this. Multiply the two. Paste. And then let's see what HZ contains. Yes. So you can see it's exactly the result that we have here. 70 plus 230 times z to the minus 1 plus 187 times z to the minus 2. So going back to the time domain, you would just see that this is the first sample, next sample, next sample, right? You just need to read out the coefficients in this case to get back to the time domain. Yeah, so that's very convenient. In this way, we have filtering and downsampling implemented by simply using this multiplication of two vectors in the z-domain, or matrix multiplication in the z-domain. We can also have a fast implementation without SymPy, because SymPy is nice for easy readability, but not so much for numerical processing. So if you have really long signals with like thousands of blocks, you wouldn't do it this way, because you wouldn't recognize anything anyway, and SymPy is too slow for it. So for that, we go back into the time domain and write our polyphase matrices as polynomials of matrix coefficients. Right? So we can say that each of our polyphase vectors is basically a polyphase matrix. And then we can rewrite this polyphase matrix as a sequence of matrices which we z-transform, which we can see here. So A of z is the sum over an times z to the minus n, and an is a matrix containing the coefficients. Same for B. So we have two polynomials containing matrices as coefficients. Yeah, so an and bn contain all the coefficients of z to the minus n, and a and nb are the length of the polynomials, so as long as they need to be. Then we get the product when we multiply the two. So we have a polynomial multiplication here. So this is then the result. We have, as a result, we get this convolution here in the inner sum. And this is because polynomial multiplication results into convolution of the coefficients. And that's also why the convolution in the z-transform turns into a multiplication. It's basically a polynomial multiplication. Right? You can also see it in this example here. We have very simple polynomials, and if you multiply the two, then as a result, the coefficients are obtained by convolution. Yeah, so in the z-domain, this is a multiplication of matrix polynomials. In the time domain, this is a convolution of matrix sequences. So here, looking at it, we have a convolution of matrix sequences in here. So remember, Here this inner sum goes over lowercase m, the block index, but z to the minus n is the index of the outer sum. So we can separately compute this inner sum here, independent of the z. And this inner sum here is simply a convolution of matrix sequences. So each an and bm is a matrix sequence, a sequence of matrices, to which we can now apply this convolution before computing the outer sum. So in Python, we can program a function which we call polmatmult a comma b, which does exactly this. Right. So here you can see it. We have a and b, two matrix sequences, and we compute convolution of those two. So here you can see it. We have the initialization of our result matrix sequence. So here you can see we have three dimensions. So NAX, NAY, and NAZ. So this is the third dimension, which denotes which matrix it is. Right? So here we have the matrix shape, AX and AY. And this is basically corresponding to the power of z. That's why I called it NAZ and NBZ. Right. So that corresponds to this exponent here. Yeah, and then we compute this result matrix C. First, we take the shape of the two inputs. Can be any sequence length and also any shape of A and B, including row vectors and column vectors. Here then it computes the resulting degree and here the resulting shape of Z and initializes it. And here you can see the resulting convolution. So here you can see the convolution here for the m. So this is this inner sum here. The sum going over lowercase m is implemented in the inner for loop. And here this if statement is just to make sure that we keep the indices in a valid range. Right? Remember, depending on how we choose m and n, we might not have valid indices here necessarily, and that's why we do this if checking. Yeah, and then here this 4 going over lowercase n is for the outer sum. Right, so going back to this equation, here this is going over the outer sum. And then as a result, we get all the polynomial coefficient matrices. So C, as a result, contains then all the matrix coefficients of our result polynomial. So in principle, this polmatmult does the polyphase multiplication in the time domain. And in this way, quite fast. Here's an application example. Take our signal and filter as in our SymPy example, but write them as polynomials of vectors. So same thing as before, right? Here also same thing as before. These are now polynomials whose coefficients are vectors, which are special matrices. In Python, we simply store the sequence of vectors with the exponent as the index in the third or last dimension, as in this function which I just showed you. Right, so again, here is my xp as before. Here is the HP, same as before, right? But now instead of using SymPy, we import my function polmatmult, which is available in Moodle 2. So you can download it from there. And then we simply apply polmatmult, the function, to XP and HP. So let me do that. So the rest is already in my IPython. So I just need to import my function. So paste. Yeah, so I imported my function and I execute it. And now yp, and you can see the result. And here you can see it's the same numbers as from SymPy, right? When you compare it, going up here to SymPy, here you can see those numbers and compare them, 70, 230, 187, right? The same samples, except that they're now right in the time domain and unlike this, which was on the Z domain, right? And that's because we did time domain implementation and computation. Yeah, so this results in the time domain corresponds indeed to the one with SymPy in the Z domain. Yeah, so here's a function to turn a signal into a polyphase vector for what we just did for X by hand. So in general, you don't want to do it by hand because when you have, for instance, audio signals, they might be hundreds of thousands of samples or even more. So it's more practical to have a function for it, basically doing the blocking. And this is an example where you can do it. So X, I call it X to polyphase. X is the input signal, for instance, the audio signal. Capital N is the downsampling factor and block length. And yeah, this converts the input signal X, a row vector, into a polyphase row vector for blocks of length capital N. So here I compute the number of blocks that we need. So I take the shape, the max shape, which means the length of X. Or if it's a stereo signal, it just takes the longest dimension, divides it by capital N, rounds it down, and takes the integer. I guess you could do the same with double slash N, then you would get the same. Yeah, so here you have the number of blocks that you need, which you can now use to initialize the XP, the polyphase version. You can see the shape. It has one row, capital N columns, and the third index, which corresponds to the exponent of Z, has length L, which is the block index. So then we go over the block index, lowercase m, and here you can see each block m gets assigned the corresponding snippet of X. So we start at m times capital N plus range capital N. So that's the number, the indices from 0 to capital N minus 1. That's all. So basically it just reshapes the input into this form. Yeah, and here we have a shape which we can use directly for polymatmult. Here's the function to turn the polyphase vector back into a sequential signal, like an audio signal. So after polymatmult, you get again a polyphase signal containing the blocks. And now you want to take all those blocks and put them one after the other, which is this function doing. It converts a polyphase input signal XP, a row vector, into a contiguous row vector for block length N, capital N, for 3D polyphase representation, where the elements of Z are in the third matrix or tensor dimension. So here we can basically extract all the necessary information from the shape of XP. N was the middle dimension, L was the last dimension, and R is not needed. This is the dimension which we assume to be 1 if it's an audio signal, or maybe 2 if it's stereo. Then we get the initialization. X is 0 of 1 comma capital N times L. So this will be the final signal length. And then we initialize, then we go over the for loop here, over the number of blocks. So basically we append another n samples from each block m. So here we have the block index. So for each block m, we just simply append it to x. And I could have used append, but actually it turns out that this is a faster implementation because I initialized the memory in this way. So pre-initializing the memory always gives speed advantages, because append always means that Python has to find the memory to assign to it. Yeah, and here I just assume that this is a one-dimensional signal. I could actually also use R here instead of 1, and then I would also have colons here instead of a 0. So this is now for one-dimensional signals. Yeah, and that's it for this set of slides. Thank you for your attention and see you in the next set of slides.